not be altered in any way. Your recording device may not be left unattended. We cannot guarantee you a power source. Your recording is not to be considered an official record of this meeting. There is only one official recording. And tonight, the official record is by our certified shorthand reporter provided by the applicant, Linda Vitone Morano, for Michelle Quick reporting. Ms. Durkin, I correct that the reporter will provide a copy of the transcript to the board.
Yes.
So that deals with recording devices.
Can I just say something with respect to recording device? Because I did submit a letter to the board dated June 13th, 2018. I trust the board has received a copy of that letter regarding your rule 411.
511.
Excuse me, 511.
Right.
And while I'm happy to hear, Mr. Newery, that the board has reviewed their rule and regulation 511, and I also did speak to the board attorney that rule requiring an authorization for the use of the definition of recording devices is in violation of the common law of New Jersey. So you are right to say that all the members, citizens, not just residents, have the right to use recording devices. They just cannot impede the hearing itself. So I did put in the request within the 7-day period, although I did put the qualification after I did the research, and I gave your attorney the case that's on point relative to the law in New Jersey regarding recording devices. Because you will certainly remember, as the members who are here at the May meeting, that there was a resident in the audience who attempted to use her cell phone to record the hearing and was shut down by the chairman and was told that if she used that recording device, she'd be asked to leave, and that whatever she put on that recording device had to be deleted. Again, that's a complete violation of the common law of New Jersey.
I'm not going to respond to those comments. It's just very simple to note that we're in agreement with regard to the manner in which recording may take place at this meeting.
You've since amended your rules?
No, we haven't. We've just made an exception. And our rule is under review.
Okay. But that we do have a transcript of that dialogue that did take place.
Which side?
Between the chairperson and the member of the audience.
Yes, that's in the transcript. I read the transcript. It's there.
Correct. It's there.
Okay, so now a couple of other matters, please. We have two members of our board who are present tonight who have signed certifications that they have either listened to the transcript or read the listened to the tape or read the transcript. Ms. Nash has read the transcript of April 19th and listened to the digital recording of May 17th. Mr. Steinhardt has listened to the digital recording of April 19th and has read the transcript of May 17th. So those certifications are on file with the secretary, and both of those board members are eligible to vote. So Ms. Durkin, you now have a full complement of 7 board members to hear your application.
Thank you very much.
Eligible to vote.
Thank you very much. I think the first order of business, as I discussed with your attorney, is one that, quite frankly, I don't take any pleasure in doing it, but it's a necessary one, and that is making a motion to ask Mr. Neuer to recuse himself because you have a disqualifying conflict. That conflict is that after the May meeting, and you recall the only witness who has testified so far on this application is Kevin Palong, the architect. He testified at the April meeting as well as at the May meeting. After the meeting, Mr. Neuer went up to Mr. Palong, and he is here, and he's going to testify, and had a conversation with him that was not innocuous. It was not benign. It was one that was directly related to the testimony that Mr. Palong, as a witness, was giving before this board. I don't need to remind the board members. I know you're all very seasoned board members, but you are a quasi-judicial board. So the appearance of an impropriety is the standard. So any time that there's a disqualifying conflict, that member should recuse themselves. I believe that the chairman, and I did also say to your attorney at the break, I wasn't quite sure, Mr. Buechler, I believe he testified or said on the record that he was recusing himself because he now has a conflict with his law firm. I didn't know Mr. Buechler to be an attorney. I don't know his law firm. I've since found out through the board that he's an attorney with Lowenstein and that they do represent Deutsche Bank. So with respect to Mr. Buechler, the question that I would have is, was that a conflict that just occurred now? Or was that conflict there prior to the April meeting? Because he sat here as the chairman and conducted the meeting in both the April and the May meetings. So that there is an issue there regarding a conflict and how the chairman conducted himself in those meetings. With respect to Mr. Neuer, I'd like to have Mr. Kalon come on up. But he's sworn in. Do you want to be sworn in? I'm just going to say, Mr. Palin.
Mr. Palin, do you swear or affirm the testimony that you have received will be the truth, the whole truth, and the whole truth?
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
And then just for the board's citing to your own rule and regulation, Article 2.05 regarding conflicts of interest, and it does state there that, and I'm quoting from your rule, when a member is in doubt concerning a potential conflict, advice of the board attorney should be sought on the record. I did not hear advice being sought from your attorney regarding either Mr. Buechler or Mr. Neuer. And then reference to the rule in the NLUL is 2:10-2. Mr. Kalin? So you're sworn in? Okay. Do you have a statement to make?
To refresh the board's memory, I am Kevin Bale, the architect for this application. I testified as such at the April and May 2018 hearings. After the second meeting, I was approached by a board member lawyer in the stairwell. He aggressively and purposely went after me regarding my testimony. Mr. Neuer, in an aggressive manner, said how I dare insult him, going on and on that I did not know him personally to assume I understand his compassion or empathy. I was taken aback as I hurried to explain to Mr. Neuer that my comments were not personal and were a hypothetical response to his hypothetical question, to which he abruptly raised his arm and voice telling me never to interrupt him. He was visibly angry, and his posture was very aggressive. I'm an architect, even on a construction site, never get confronted like this. He then began to lecture me. We fell back to silence and disagreement as we parted ways. It was the strangest exchange I have ever had in town. It seemed like a dignified sectarian, but he is a verbal pugilist, experienced in legal brawls that I am not here for. I tried to remain calm and did not want to engage in any conversation with Mr. Neuer regarding the application, because I felt it was totally inappropriate for Mr. Neuer, as a member of the board, to speak to me outside of the hearing regarding my testimony while the application is still. I would not want whatever personal bias Mr. Neuer may have towards me to affect this application or impede this application from being approved in any way. I would not want the board to be tainted by what board member Neuer may perceive or think of me.
Broached the subject with me on the telephone in between the hearings and advised me that you were not present, but the only one present was Mr. Neuer and Mr. Colon. And I asked you to provide me the factual basis for Mr. Colon's complaint, which you wanted to do so, or you did not do so. So I think I do have to ask Mr. Neuer to address the allegations of Mr. Colon.
I'm just going to place a little bit of an objection right there. The factual basis was just given as testimony that was just put on the record here. And I did respectfully make two phone calls with you on this subject. One was just to alert you of the conversation that Mr. Palin had had with me with respect to the exchange that Mr. Neuer felt the need to have with him after the meeting, and to explore that, because it was certainly I thought I'd pick up the phone and ask you how you felt about that in the conversation that we had. I followed up that conversation, and your words were Mr. Neuer didn't feel the need to step down. He felt that his conversation was benign. So you asked me to provide testimony, and I told you I would assume you provide the testimony, which is good.
What would you like, counsel? Because I would refer the matter to you. I think it would be inappropriate for me to rule on a motion involving my own recusal.
I think you should place something on the record. I'll place you under oath. Place something on the record of your version of the incident. Mr. Neuer, do you swear from the testimony you're about to give, receiving the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
Yes, I do.
Thank you. Please tell us back your version of the incident.
Certainly. I was going down the stairway. I saw Mr. Payon. We smiled at each other, and then I said, Mr. Payon, you really were out of line in accusing me and other members of the court of being compassionate. I did not address the substance of his testimony. I did not address anything regarding what he testified to, other than his accusation that me and other members of the board were not being compassionate for the young gentleman who's the subject matter of this application. That was the sum and substance of our conversation. I did not raise my voice. I did not yell or scream. I did not threaten him. I do not understand his reaction. And I can honestly and candidly state that I will not hold anything against Mr. Payon. I have sat on this board for over a decade, and I have exercised my judgment in a fair and impartial manner. And I will continue to do so in this application. We had a disagreement over one word. If I could withdraw one word that I said on a number of occasions, I would gladly do so. I didn't ask him to withdraw it. I simply told him that I took umbrage with that expression.
Do you feel that you can sit on this application knowing what Mr. Plone has just said and knowing that the motion is debate? Can you feel that you can sit here and partially judge this application?
Absolutely.
Mr. Neuer, did you after the May meeting, you as a member went and spoke to Mr. Payon? Is that your testimony? That after the meeting, you in fact went up to Mr. Payon to discuss his testimony with him?
No. We were going down the stairway together. I didn't approach him. We were going down the stairs together. But I repeated what I had said on the record. I made a comment on the record that he was out of line and accusing us of not being compassionate. That was it. It had nothing to do with the substance of his testimony.
That wasn't the testimony of Mr. Payon, but let's put that aside for a moment. The question is, you, as a board member, after the May meeting, after the meeting had closed, had gone up to Mr. Payon in the stairwell, and you discussed with him your view of his testimony.
That's not an accurate statement, counsel. You're trying to put words in my
mouth. I'm not trying to put words in your mouth. I'm trying to understand the exchange.
I clearly testified as to the exchange. I told him that he was out of line and accusing me and other members of this board of not being compassionate to the applicant. Period. I didn't discuss the ramp. I didn't discuss any other aspect of his testimony. All I did was tell him that that was an inappropriate comment.
And those words that you spoke to Mr. Payon were words you spoke to him outside of the hearing. Is that correct?
Absolutely correct.
Okay. That in and of itself, sir, is a disqualifying conduct.
I leave that to my attorney. Okay.
You, as a board member, after the hearing, went up to the witness.
No. I told you three times I didn't go up to him. We were going down the stairway together. I didn't seek him out. I didn't try to challenge him. We found ourselves together in the stairway.
So let me understand, since you're making an issue with going down the stairs, were there other people going down the stairs as well?
Certainly.
Okay. Did you speak to any of the other people?
No.
Okay. So, and you spoke first to Mr. Payon regarding his testimony, correct? Mm-hmm.
We made eye contact and I opened my mouth, yes.
So you approached him. You made the first move with respect to the conversation that you had with Mr. Payon, who's a witness, in a matter that you're sitting as a board member, and now tonight sitting as the chair. Respectfully, sir, that's a disqualifying conflict.
I respectfully disagree, but I leave the determination to my counsel.
permits.
I can say, Mr. Neuer did not have to speak to Mr. Palin. And discretion being the better part of valor, any board member or anybody in a judicial or quasi-judicial position do not speak to witnesses outside of the hearing room on a pending matter. Otherwise, you're disqualified.
I don't find the transaction to be disqualifying because it was not speaking about the substance of the application. And therefore, I rule it, or I guess I'm making a ruling, that I don't feel Mr. Neuer is disqualified from participating in this matter.
Have you made a sufficient record, Ms. Turner?
I couldn't disagree with you more.
Have you made a sufficient record?
I'm finishing my sentence, Mr. Neuer. Okay. And I think that that is in violation of the MLUL, and the case that I'll cite to you is Zoe versus Zoning Board of Adjustment of Borough of Monmouth Beach, 260 NJ Super 341. Okay. And quoted in there, the impartiality, indeed the appearance of impartiality in board proceedings is a matter of overriding public interest. There's no way that Mr. Neuer, who went up to a witness after a hearing on a matter that not only is he going to have a vote on, this evening he's sitting as the chair, and he has testified that he's been a member of this board for a very long period of time. So I'm going to assume that he has some sway, and I know him to be a previous attorney. That he should never have gone there. The reason for the disqualifications was not one created by the applicant. It was one totally within control of Mr. Neuer. Mr. Neuer is the one who chose to speak to the witness, and he should never have come. As I said, if it were but a benign conversation, the weather, a sports team, no problem. It was not a benign conversation. It was specifically going after him regarding his testimony. You're also saying whether or not that testimony is material or not to this application. And this board, we're asking for a C variance. That variance is a majority of a quorum, as this board knows, in order to approve. You have 7 members here. Mr. Neuer could very easily recuse himself, and there's still enough members here for this matter to proceed this evening.
The attorney has ruled. The board attorney has ruled. I referred to her because I wasn't going to make the decision, because she recused me and asked me to make a decision on my own recusal. I will not answer the question. I defer to counsel. You have the opinion of counsel. I respectfully request that you move on with your application.
Mr.
I'm not stepping down.
You're not stepping down.
No.
Well, you have a disqualifying conflict. I put it on the record.
You keep saying it, and the more you say it, the more times it's just going to suck up time in the record. So please get on with your application.
You do not decide, is the board attorney here in your records that you make that decision? I'm just asking.
It's common sense since we don't want Mr. Neuer to make the decision.
So, but he could step down, the board can make a motion.
Because I don't want to make a motion to have Mr. Neuer step down.
I hear what you say. Can I think that there's a lot of adversarial back and forth between the two of you. This has nothing to do with maybe what Phil said. I personally don't like this. It makes me feel horrible. I don't like it at all. And part of it, I think, comes from you, and part comes from him. And that part is what I don't like. I'm going to move on. And if you're adamant, he's adamant, I don't really care. What, either way. I don't think he meant, I think he was personally offended, and I don't think he was talking about the testimony. And Phil is an honest, good guy, and he can make an honest decision. But there's such animosity between the two of you that, I don't know, it's terrible. It's awful. Very upset.
There's no animosity on my part.
I think from both ends, and
I have no say in it. There is, trust me, it's coming across that way. If you don't feel that way, I'm telling you that it is.
Respectfully, Member Weiss, as an attorney, I have a duty and an obligation when a conflict presents itself to raise it. And I did not do that, just so you understand, because you just raised some, and quite frankly, you never had that spoken to me before in this board. If I did not do that, I would not be representing my client. I am here representing a client. And the thing to be mindful, because I'm not contentious at all with Mr. Neuer, to be mindful of this specific instance and why I was so taken back by it, because it didn't need to occur, and it shouldn't have occurred. And the only control in that whole action was Mr. Neuer. He knows he should never have gone to a witness after a hearing. So I'm obligated to put that objection on the record. So you can't hold me for doing what I'm obligated to do.
I hear you, but I'm just talking about an adversarial, and maybe it's a lawyer to a lawyer, but there's an adversarial feeling. That's all, and I don't know if the rest of you feel that way. So I've said my piece. I just said Phil can rise to the occasion. He's a terrific guy, and he is a good lawyer, and that's my opinion, and anyone else should do that.
Reserving your right to continue with your application.
Okay. This evening, I have three witnesses with me.
I'm sorry, one other thing, Ms. Durkin, I think that you will appreciate this. Board, we received communication from an attorney for neighboring property owners who had previously appeared in objection to the application. The owners of Elaine and Michael Collin at 114 40 Avenue, so I don't know their attorney, Bruce Collin, Esquire.
Can't hear.
In which he states, our clients are sympathetic to the applicant's need for an access ramp and the safety of the applicant's handicapped child. Our specific requests are that the applicant be required to submit an as-built survey to the board after completion of any side ramp to assure that it does not encroach on our client's property. Second, that the bushes that exist along the common property line and the common side of the property line provide a buffer from the applicant's property. While the applicant may trim any bushes hanging over the property line, the bushes should otherwise be left intact to provide the necessary buffer. The board will take those comments into consideration. However, we do know that this former objective owner objects to the applicant.
For the records, I don't have any recollections on the testimony that anybody made an appearance as an objector.
There was not a formal appearance.
There was no appearance on behalf. Say that again, Mr. Mayor?
There was no formal appearance on the record. You are correct.
So there was no formal appearance by these neighbors, although they were here both evenings. They were here in April and they were here in May, correct?
I don't have a recollection on my idea. I don't.
They were here, and I can recollect you having some discussions with them. So you may not remember that, that's fine. But I'm going to object to this letter. The board should give no consideration to this letter. We have absolutely no Mr. Cohn should have come this evening or at the other meetings and put an appearance on the record and state what it is that they're objecting to. What it is that they're objecting to. They're the next door neighbors, Mr. and Mrs. Cohen, and I assume friends of theirs because they came in a large group, and their attorney were here in the April meeting and the May meeting. We have no problem to address an objection that anybody may have on this application, but they have to state that objection. They don't get a right to submit a letter to this board for consideration of certain conditions that they would want the board to take into their purview without us having an opportunity to, one, understand nice, but we can't accept it. Because it's not, so I'm struggling to understand, rightfully, Mr. Neuer.
The letter will simply be placed in the file, and it's not evidence.
No, we're going to mark that letter in, because you just read it into the record, so I'm going to mark it in as A4.
Mr. Chairman, may I make a request that every member sitting at this table there speak into the microphone, hold the microphone and speak in. I can hear you, you have a deep voice. Many people here may or may not have hearing impairments, cannot hear what you are saying.
We accept your comment. Members of the board, please pay attention to the request.
Ms. Byrne, would you please kind of speak slowly and carefully into the microphone? I know you're a long time. Thank you.